The things that happen in my life are determined by three factors. First, my own intelligence, which is free. Second, the deterministic act of nature. And third, the random act of nature. If you can think of fourth factor, please tell me. I have been thinking a lot. Is there a fourth factor which decides how things will happen in my life? I could not come across, but if you come across, please tell me. So these three factors determine how things happen in my life. Everything. Coming to give a lecture, now I am going to Himachal to set up a school. All this is act of these three factors. My own intelligence, deterministic act of nature, because my body is there, body has a genetics, okay? Given the genetics, I have, you know, certain known things that whether I will be disease-free or I will have certain diseases. This is a deterministic act of nature. We don't want it, but nature has done it. Whether my birth was, whether my existence was required or not, nobody asked me. Nature did it. Okay, so it happened with me. So all the things, and the third factor is randomness of nature, which some people even call as destiny. Some mere bhagya mein hai. It was in my luck to come to Bikaner. Okay, so this is nothing but scientifically randomness of nature. Randomly, you know, we pick up this fellow to be Shah Rukh Khan, we pick up that fellow to be a beggar. Okay, so one fellow becomes Shah Rukh Khan, another fellow becomes beggar. We may say it is randomness of nature because he was born like that. He was born with all the qualities which he has, and the other fellow was born like that. So random act of nature, some people call as destiny. Okay, so intelligence, deterministic act of nature, and random act of nature. So your future will always depend on these three factors. Now let us ask a question. Can I control that deterministic act of nature? Perhaps not, because it is act of nature. Nature is doing it to me. My aging is deterministic act of nature. It's a law of nature. You were tiny infant one day, today you are grown up, handsome and beautiful boys and girls. Nature has done it. Okay, but this thank you is act of intelligence. This nature has not done it. Okay, his intelligence is, he liked it, so he expressed it. Okay, and you happen to be student of physics or engineering, is also your act of intelligence, act of nature, and your destiny. So all the three acts played the role. Okay? So in all these three factors, one factor which you can control, and only one factor which you can control, is act of intelligence. Act of nature which is deterministic, you cannot control. Act of nature which is random, you cannot control. Accept it happily. Okay, we are part of nature, we belong to nature. Nature doesn't belong to us. Some people think we should control nature. No. If you control nature, nature will retaliate. Okay? But we belong to nature. We are the sons and daughters of nature, all of us. Okay? So, intelligence is the only factor which you can control. There, nature has given you freedom. Now let us discuss that. When I said in the beginning that today our question is, are our minds prepared for future? This is the question, to face the challenges. Okay? Mind is nothing but, you know, intelligence. After all, intelligence and mind, they are related to each other. Mind is much bigger. Intelligence makes mind sharper or duller. If you have higher intelligence, mind will be sharper. You will have more joy in life. In fact, my belief is that lots of problems, not all, because some problems are controlled by part 2 and part 3, that means acts of nature. Not that part. But lots of problems we can solve through intelligence. And intelligence is so powerful. I tell you, intelligence can make human being even a god. If you have a definition of God, intelligence can make that. Intelligence can also make a human being a beggar. So, intelligence is very, very important. I think one factor which decides our future, our success of life, our happiness of life, our achievements of life depends on intelligence. So the question we are asking today, how to prepare that mind or intelligence so as to face the future? When you make a transition from student life to a professional life, you will be professionals. I can see some of you wonderful engineers, wonderful scientists. Some of you will have your own ideas, own businesses, and try to do that, because now forget government jobs. Okay? Don't depend on government. See, Abdul Kalam ji, he used to say, our education should not produce job seekers. You are the ones who can be job producers. You can give job to others. Think like that. Don't think that, let us see the advertisement. Where is the position for lecturers or teachers? Or where is the position for engineers in BSNL? Or in some auto company if you are a mechanical engineer? Don't think like that. Better you don't think like that. Rather think, what should I do so that each one of you gives jobs to two or three other people who maybe are not even educated, but you can make them educated. Education itself is a huge industry. And in our country, where there is a large population still not educated, education is a very important part of sharpening the mind, taking the mind from lower level to higher level. We all are blessed. We all are really lucky in terms of, you know, third factor, the act of nature, which is destiny. We were destined to have such high education. We are doing PhDs and all that. But look at the masses of our own country, who are our brothers and sisters. They are not even educated. I can take this as a job. To give you an example, you know, there is a fellow called, his name is Vinayak Lohani. Yes, Vinayak Lohani. He did B.Tech from IIT Kharagpur, very high institute, IIT Kharagpur. Then he did MBA from IIM Kolkata, most probably Kolkata if I remember correctly. So a graduate of IIT Kharagpur and IIM Kolkata, what would you normally expect from him? Go for a multinational company. How much salary they would get? Something like 3-4 crores per month. He could have done that. But what he did? He picked up 3 children from the street and started a school for them. Today he has 1,500 children. His NGO is called Parivar. If you can Google Parivar. Okay? He's after doing engineering, after doing MBA, what he selected? To be a mentor, to be an organizer of an institute which will teach poor children of Bengal and even other parts of the country. This is a great profession. Why did he choose that? His act of intelligence. This is not act of nature, either deterministic or random. One may say, of course, it was his destiny. You can always say that. But his intelligence did that. Why did he do that? Because he was driven by an inner passion. Okay? So when I say that we have to prepare our minds, one factor which is very, very important is that we should have our minds positive. Negative minds will destroy the society. Let us never think of that. Okay, when I say positive minds, you know, in our Vedanta, there is a very systematic definition. Even in Western psychology, there is a very clear understanding that what is a positive mind. If young people like us, as I also consider myself a young brother of yours, okay, 40 years late, earlier I was young brother, so today I consider that, okay. Think of a positive mind, we can make a beautiful society. And India, a nation, which, you know, anyway people are now looking at it. Okay, especially, you know, you are seeing what is happening in USA these days. Okay, now people are looking at India. Okay, growing economy, and also people who have an ancient knowledge of Vedantic level. What is a Vedantic level of knowledge? Means a knowledge which is good for each and every human being, not only each and every human being, but each and every living being. We are so much concerned about even plants, animals, insects. Okay? So, what's a positive mind? In Indian Vedantic sense, we have four kinds of minds, four paths which a mind can follow. In Western philosophy, we have only three kinds of mind. So this is one kind of mind which is specific to our culture, our knowledge. Okay? So what are these four kinds of minds? Which three kinds are also in Western psychology? Let us try to understand it. In Vedantic philosophy, we have Kam, Arth, Dharma, Moksha. Okay? Four kinds of minds. Kam, pleasure. This is also in Western philosophy. In Western philosophy, there are three kinds of minds. Pleasure, which is Kam. Then engagement, which is Arth. Then meaning, which is Dharma. But fourth kind of mind is not in Western philosophy. It is in Vedantic philosophy, Moksha. So, the lowest kind of mind is Kama. Mind which is engaged in pleasure all the time. Boys, they want motorbike, and roaming around, preferably a girl behind, okay? And seeing cinemas, okay? Wasting time, passing comments on others. This is all calm. It may give you pleasure, but it will not give you joy. It will not give you happiness. You can try it. Ask those fellows who are doing all this, you know, so-called pleasure-like things. Are they happy people? They'll say, I'm not educated. They never succeeded in education. They cannot do anything for others. Not a good idea. So calm. This is one kind of mind. Okay, we are talking of mind today. Okay? Arth, which most of us are. Paisa kamalo, earn money and save it. This is typical Indian psychology. You know, the one country which saves the maximum money earned from abroad. Have you seen that statistics? India. Number one. Not even China. Although number of Chinese abroad is very large. But maximum money which comes from foreign to India, from the sons and grandsons and brothers and sisters, is by Indians. They like to save. Save for what? God knows. But they think we save it for future. Future which perhaps doesn't even exist for them. It may exist for others, their children or grandchildren. Okay? And they don't even spend on philanthropic acts. Okay? Very rarely you will find that some Sethji made a school, but he will give a big name to of his own. Said so and so school. Philanthropic act, good, But many schools will like to earn more. They will say, we spent 5 crore, we want 20 crores now. Okay, this is not a positive mind. But this is earth, earning, material comfort, materialistic mind, which in Western psychology is called engagement. That means you are engaged in some activity, but you are concerned with worldly things. Okay? Money, cars, aeroplanes, okay? Schools, hospitals, my name, fame. Okay? This is all worldly things. Okay? So earth is another path which the mind follows. Third is dharma, which most of us also follow because we believe there is a life after death. So for the sake of good next life, people, you know, give dan dakshina, donations, or even they, you know, pay income tax. Not all of them, but many of them, they say, okay, let us pay. Okay. So following the laws is dharma. Okay. Which in Western psychology is called meaning. That you have given some meaning to your life. Okay. You have something higher in your life other than physical existence. Physical existence is there, but there is something higher than that. So let us give a meaning to life. That means help others, okay, serve others, okay, give others. In Western psychology they say like that. In our philosophy we say dharma means follow the rules. This is my dharma. Okay, if I am a student, I should follow the rule of college or education system. If I am a husband, I should follow the dharma of a husband. Okay, if I am a father, I should follow the rules which are not written, but it is understood that as a father, how I should behave. So I should behave that way. This is third kind of mind. And the fourth kind of mind, which is unique to Vedantic philosophy or Indian psychology, is moksha. Very less number of people, but they are also in plenty. Because India is a country of population. So, in every group there are huge number of people. So, there are people who work not for karma, not for earth, not for dharma even. They work for moksha. What is moksha? In simple words, it makes us higher than what a normal, natural human being would be. When I do, you know, earning for myself, when I write a paper, for example, as a scientist, I was writing papers. I do it as a karma. I do it for myself, that if I don't write a paper, my promotion will not take place. This is a karma, driven by earth and dharma. But if I write a paper for the benefit of others, if I keep others before me, then that karma becomes karma yoga. And then that is the path of moksha. Forget yourself. Others first. Okay. There is a very nice definition which I heard in a lecture. That a person who follows the path of moksha, when he closes his eyes, he is very peaceful and calm inside. He has no desire whatsoever. No desire for himself. And when he opens the eyes, he asks, what can I do for you? This is the path of moksha. Gandhiji, for example, you know, he was not undertaking satyagraha or you know, all these movements or even upvas for his own political gain. He was never doing that. If he wanted, he could have been easily President of India or Prime Minister of India, because he was number one. But he never did all this for his personal gains. He had just one langoti, an ashram, but he was doing it for others. For the self-respect of a country, that we can rule ourselves. You have to go out. You are no one to rule us. And that too he was telling it in a non-violent way. This is the mark of moksha. Moksha doesn't mean that go to a you know, forest or sit, you know, in meditation, eat fruits, forget world. That is not a good form. I don't agree with that. You know, we are born human being, and we just sit like a stone. Our society needs us. There are so many people who are waiting for us, leaving all them, leaving our beloved ones, leaving our own brothers and sisters, sitting in a forest. It's very easy for him to be a monk or a sadhu and leave the world. No, this world is karmbhumi, and this karmbhumi requires our karma yoga. And if my karma becomes karma yoga, that is the path of moksha. Moksha is not sitting alone in a forest. You see, living in family is very tough. Okay, when you become fathers, you see, handling children, oh my God, it's very, very, you have to be very patient. All the mothers will agree with me, yeah? Those who are mothers will agree with me, you know? Lovingly, the one who is, you know, fighting with you, you have to love. How tough it is. But this is karma yoga. And this when you do for others, like in the example I gave you, Vinayak Luhani. He is doing it for poor children. Now he has 1,500 children. Please Google this, Parivar. This is an NGO. Okay. After having done BE and MBA, he is serving poor children. Why? Because he is following his inner instinct, his inner call of having the mind of moksha. This is moksha. He didn't leave the world. He said, I'll make the world better. Because of me, these children will study. 1,500 children. And his target is 2,000 children by the end of 2020. Okay? In coming few years. Okay? This is the mark of moksha. Moksha is not go to forest or sit alone, enjoy your life the way you like. Not like. Struggle. Give others. Make others' life what you want to be. Okay, he didn't even marry this fellow. Okay, he is serving only others. So, when I say that are our minds prepared for future, please consider this, keeping in mind. Would you like to have a job from others, or would you like to give others a job? This is the question you would think. And I can tell you the kind of ideas which we have. Someone may ask, what should I do? I can tell you even today at least 100 ideas which you can do. Even if you have no money to start with. But you have intelligence. You have knowledge. Okay? You have learned something. You have learned science and technology. This is the temple of science and technology. So once you are educated, the meaning of education is that now you can apply that education for the growth of joy, life, livelihood for others. And when you keep others before you, that is the best and the true moksha mark according to Vedanta. Now it is for individual to think that what should I actually do, and we can have a discussion on that. Okay? So this is the kind of mind we are looking for. So a mind which is highly concentrated, huge concentration is again very important for learning things, because if you do not learn things, here I would like to say something in let's say a couple of minutes. See, many a time we think that this subject I cannot understand, let me memorize it. Am I right? Even I was doing that, honestly speaking. Yeah? Maka. Ratna. No? And then write the same language of the book in the notebook, in the answer book of exam. And you get very good marks. I have an experience. Okay? You get very good marks if you reproduce the language. Because professors also like that. Sorry for that, but this is a fact. Okay? Our professors also came from that system. Maybe they also did that. Maybe. Okay? With due respect to, I am also a professor, okay, at a university in Mumbai. But did we ever think that mucking up is actually a waste of time because we don't learn anything from that? Now someone may ask, then how to learn? Nobody even told us. I want to learn, I want to understand. How should I do that? Because if I just listen to lectures, passive listener, like we are doing now, but we will have an activity after this lecture. How do I learn? Very nice question, fundamental question. Then we have some suggestions. One of my suggestions is, before you read a chapter, or before you listen to a lecture, for example, let us say there is a, let us take subject of computer sciences, microprocessor. Okay? Good subject? So let us say there is a lecture going to be on microprocessors today, or I have to learn what are microprocessors. I would suggest before that lecture or before reading that, sit for maybe half an hour or 1 hour, and you know, human mind has a wonderful capability which computers don't have. Computers are after all idiot machines. They can handle large number of data, but can they think? No. Can they generate ideas? No. Okay. They can only process ideas. They can only process data. Like a machine. But we human beings have a very, very important capability given by nature to generate questions, to generate ideas, okay? To generate curiosity. Before reading that chapter, let us say in our example on microprocessor, you sit down, ask yourself some questions, you know? You will immediately think, what's a microprocessor? Isn't it? This is a natural question. What's a microprocessor? There are two words in this, micro and processor. So something has to be micro, that means small, and something has to be there to process it. How does it process? You know, brain processes information, okay? We get information and we process it and we react, okay? But how does a set of, you know, transistors, how does a set of transistor processes ideas or data? So before the lecture or before reading it, if you sit down for half an hour or 1 hour and generate these questions, then go to the lecture or then read the chapter, you will understand. Do we do it? Yes? Fantastic. Then you would have really understood the subject. If you have done it, you will understand the subject. So what is understanding? When do we say that I have understood the subject? When I can apply that knowledge in new situations. For example, I have learned about microprocessor, but I want to carry out some activity, for example, in a washing machine or in a mobile. Okay, can microprocessor do that? If I have understood microprocessor, I can find an answer. But if I mugged it up, I'll be blank. I can tell you, if you have understood, it will never let you down. When you go for interviews, for example. Okay. Many interviews we fail because we don't actually understand the subject. And in interviews we are nervous because those, you know, old fellows with white beard and white mustache are looking at you through the specs. And you feel nervous, I don't know what he will ask. As if he is a, you know, hawa, or he is some kind of devil. Okay, and you are nervous, and nervousness erases memory. So all that which you memorized is gone. But all that which you understood will give your company. Understanding will never let you down. Okay, I remember a very nice, you know, humorous story about you know, a student memorizing an essay. You know, in schools we get to write essays in exams. Okay? in 5th, 6th, up to 10th. Okay, I remember I used to also write essays. So, one way is to understand how to write an essay. Okay, that means you have to describe something. Teacher should tell that when you observe something, you can understand that subject. For example, there is cow, there is school, there is school teacher, or there is garden, or so many subjects. Okay? But you know, a boy, he was only memorizing. In this story which I am telling you, there is a boy who used to only memorize. He will roam around and cram or mug up things. So he mugged up one essay on school. Okay? So he says, I know at least know one essay. So he went to exam, but in the exam, it was written, write an essay on cow. Now he is in trouble. Because he didn't understand how to write an essay. He has only mugged up one essay on school. But he was a clever boy. So he started like this. There was a cow, it entered a school. Then he wrote entire essay on school. Finally he wrote cow came out of school. So Jai Mata. Yeah. This is what the people who mug up are. Na? But he was a little clever. At least he could connect cow with the school and write entire essay on the school. Okay? Do we want to be like this? Not at all. Okay, then people will make joke of us. Okay? That he does not understand. So understanding, clarity of subject, these are very important. Now some student may ask, see there is a huge syllabus. How to understand entire thing? I agree with that. It's a huge syllabus. There are some 5 subjects, 20, 30 chapters in each subject, and in 30 chapters there are some 10 sections. Okay, to understand this huge thing, I would think, you know, you have to be really, we have to be rather, really like Rishi Munis, cut off from the rest of the world. Because you know, the cognitive power, the power to understand is limited. Okay, this we know. We cannot, you know, take so much of information into us, then we will stop, you know, registering that. We will stop reacting to that or understanding that. So confine yourself. You know, if you go to IIT libraries, IIT Kanpur, for example, I visited many times. There, you know, students study like this. They cut off their ears, even vision. So they actually see the book like this. No other signal should come. You should cut off all other signals, inside and outside. Inside mind, only focus on one thing. And of course, there are Indian ways, there are techniques. You know, there are 8 methods of generating inner concentration. Okay, like, you know, there are yam, niyam, asana, okay, pranayam, pratyahar, sadhana, dhyan, samadhi. So there are 8 methods, and these methods we have to practice. You know, people used to practice it in gurukuls, and their concentration was so huge. Let there be earthquake, but they will be focused on what they are doing. So we think that we should have minds like this. Now let me summarize. See, what will happen in our life depends on 3 things. Our intelligence, deterministic acts of nature, and random acts of nature, which people call as destiny. Now, to have a wonderful intelligence, we need following things. First, a very positive mind, mind which is working for moksha, not for kama, artha, dharma. Okay. Moksha marga. That means karma is transformed into karma yoga, others before me. Because me is you, in Vedantic sense. Me and you are not separate. We all came from the same atoms which were produced 13.7 billion years ago in a Big Bang. Scientifically, we know that. These atoms of which some people say, you know, when you ask someone, what is your age? Okay. He'll say, I'm 30 years, 20 years. No. You are 13.4 billion years old. because the atoms of which you and me are made are 13.7 billion years old. So our material of the body is that old. We are so senior. Okay, all right. So we have to have all this positivity in our mind, because me and you are the same. So a positive mind, a focused mind, a mind which is working for others, okay, and a mind which understands things. Let us not mug up. Okay, this exam is too close, so don't change your techniques. Whatever techniques you have, you follow that. But please understand that we should understand. Okay, if we understand, we can generate lot of knowledge out of our learning. Okay, and we can be job producers rather than job seeker, as Kalam sahab used to say. Okay, so should we stop here? Thank you very much.